Welcome to RadioRegion.com, the voice of your community. Contact us at 647-344-4134.
The story of the hurricane, the many authorities came to blame for something that he never done. But in a prison cell for one time, he could have been the champion of the world. And he stops. One of us had better call up the cops. And so Patty calls the cops, and they arrive on the scene with the red lights flashing in a hot New Jersey night.
Welcome to Dum Dums, the show where we pose pedestrian questions to experienced experts. Today we're going to be doing a bit of weaving, but not with thread or yarn. We're going to be weaving with words, weaving together some tales, some stories. We're going to be talking about the art of storytelling. So we'll get into that and a lot more coming right at you. And thanks for joining us, as always. I'm your host, Donny Kehoe.
And I'm Hannon Eunice.
And as always, we have producer Alex behind the glass. Hannon, Toronto weather update for you. It is garbage out.
I know.
Garbage weather.
I know, it's actually the worst. It couldn't be worse. Yeah. Well, it could be. But
well, yeah.
It's just sad.
Yeah, it is. I think we might be in for some good weather coming up on the weekend, or so my weather network app has told me, and they are never wrong.
Never.
So we have that to look forward to, but right now, yeah, it's raining out, it's dark, it's gloomy.
Mm-hmm.
I was just starting to enjoy the sunlight, return of sunlight.
Ugh.
It's been a long weekend here. We actually had a little bit of a contest last week. You weren't here with us, but we were talking to a couple of farmers, and we asked the audience, the listeners, if anyone could name the 4-H's from 4-H Club, took a bit of time. Nobody got that one right off the bat, but eventually we got to a winner over Twitter. Can I put our producer Alex on the spot here? I don't know the name of the winner offhand. It was via Twitter, so we're just going to look that up and give our grand announcement of the prize.
You're not stalling.
No, not stalling at all. What's our password? What's our Twitter password? Do you know what they are? You didn't see the answer.
What is it?
4-H.
4-H? And it's 4-H. In regards to farming?
Yes. And the it's
hose?
No.
Like, and
yes, I know what you mean, but
okay. like, hands?
Hands are one.
Hands? Yep. Okay. Hands, herd?
No. It's not that literal.
Oh, okay.
It's, and going off of memory here, from when Alex told me the answer a couple days ago, but I believe it's hands, heart, head, and Well, I lost that Twitter contest. Alex, would you like to enlighten us?
Yes, it was Jordan Case, who from Orangeville, who
Ooh.
Actually won and had the correct answer. First person to have the correct answer. There was actually several people who wrote in and had the correct answer, but only one winner, unfortunately. And the 4 H's: head, heart, hands and health.
Health.
Yes.
That makes sense. Yeah.
What did he win?
Actually, a $10 iTunes gift card.
Oh, this is the show
that gives back. And we'd like to thank everyone who tweeted in their answers there. And if you'd like to get involved in this week's show or at any point, you can tweet us at Dum Dums Radio. Yeah. How do you spell that, Annan?
At D-U-M-D-U-M-S. D-U-M-S. I don't know if I slurred that. I'm the worst. Let me do it again.
And our Facebook page is also Dum Dums Radio, so you can leave us a comment there. Give us a like. We always appreciate getting feedback from people. And this week, I'm going to ask the folks out there, if you have a story, an interesting story, something that happened to you in real life, give us a tweet. I mean, you might have to condense it. There's a certain size restriction for Twitter, but hey, and you know what? You can always give us a call in as well. We love to get call-ins. The number here is 647-344-4134. That's radioregent.com. So we're gonna get right to it. We're gonna introduce our guests here. As I mentioned, we're talking to a couple of storytellers today. So today in the studio, we have a bit of a packed room here. We have our guests, Rabina Sinha, is that correct? And also Joanna Chapman-Smith. Thanks for joining us.
And her
and as well
storytelling partner.
And a storytelling...
your name was Ewan?
Yeah. And Ewan as well, who you might not hear. He's a little bit in the... in the back here, but you will hear him later because Joanna and Ewan, yeah, actually are musical storytellers. So we're going to get a little...
He's gonna tell stories with his melodious flugelhorn.
Yes.
Yes, yes, yes.
That's so beautiful.
Those dulcet brass tones.
That's right, that's right.
Perfect. I'll get right into it. For those who may not have a good concept of what modern storytelling is, like, how would you define that?
Modern storytelling?
Yes, and in the current, how do you define storytelling for what you do?
Well,
personally?
Storytelling does exist until the people started talking.
Yeah.
So it's from grandmother, great great grandmother, people. Talked about stories all their life. There was nothing new about storytelling. What happening storytelling today is we are defining how we tell stories, right? Because anything, any art form you see or you even listen, it's stories.
Mm-hmm.
Dance is a story. Music is a story. Poetry. Music is a poetry. So anything you think of, you know, like there are so many different kind of stories. You know, people write books, novels. They're all stories, right?
Yeah.
So stories being here on this earth for a long, long, long time.
And what kind of storytelling do you do, Rabina?
I'm from India, so I like to stay in that area of India, but I try to tell stories, except, you know, that when you tell stories from other countries, you have to have that something about them inside of you. If you don't know, if you have the accent or if you know how to manipulate your tongue to speak it, like Irish stories, you know, they have a special kind of ways to tell stories. Those kind of things, if you don't have it, don't go in there. Because it will be just a story then. So that's why I'm trying to stay that area. But mythology stories are very important to me. Mythology stories comes from China, Japan, or India, all over. So Greek. You know, they're all mythology stories. So I love those stories. And, whatever hits me, I get hold of it and I try to tell it.
Nice.
Oh, wow. And, Joanna, how did you get involved in storytelling yourself?
I've always loved stories. And music and stories, I sort of have a knack for just remembering them. And so... I sort of told stories all my life but didn't really realize – I didn't think I was a storyteller. There was an assignment one time in high school where we were supposed to tell stories. And because I was thinking about it, I did terribly. The whole thing stressed me out. But then years later, I saw a theater show that had storytelling in it, and it just reconnected me to stories. And I met the storyteller and couldn't convince them to ever storytell in public ever again. So I started having to do it myself. So I started researching folktales. I took every single folktale book out of the local library and read through them all, and started telling stories again. And yeah, I love them.
And you're also a singer-songwriter. Mm-hmm. So, like, is there a difference between just being a musician and being sort of a musical storyteller? Is it?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a difference between every storyteller and every other storyteller. So I think it's just even more pronounced when you're going from one medium to another. So telling stories through music, there's a lot you can do without words, mm-hmm. which isn't, you know, the kind of musicality that I have because I've been a singer-songwriter for so many years, it helps then when I go into regular storytelling too, because I do think about, and even just subconsciously, I think about pacing, I think about the musicality of the voice as I tell. And, you know, a story can have its legato sections and its staccato sections, and it can have, you know, all these sorts of things. Yeah.
And I'm sure a lot of people here in Toronto wouldn't even know like where to go if they wanted to listen to storytelling. How to find that? How would you help people if they're interested in this or in doing it themselves? Like, how would someone get started in that?
Yeah, it's there is information for Storyteller. It's Toronto Storytelling school. It used to be a school, but not anymore. It's just the organization.
Storytelling Toronto.
If they can Google it and see what they have. And they have lots of classes and lots of tell you where it's happening and everything. All the information is really there.
I would visit that website for sure, Storytelling Toronto. But also there are weekly events that happen in the city that are great just to drop in and check them out. So on Friday nights, there's an event called 1001 Nights.
Yeah, and Saturday also.
Of storytelling.
Witchwood Barn.
At Witchwood Barns on Saturday.
They have storytelling thing in the morning. These places are very, you can walk in and tell your story.
Yeah. So both of those are for
very
sort
important.
Of a mix of types of stories and a lot of folk tales and some true stories. And then there are some in the city which are more for telling your personal stories, like true life stories.
Okay. Oh.
So there's a group called the Raconteurs who meet regularly.
Yeah, that I don't know.
And you could probably just Google and find all the things. But it's fun to know that there are weekly events all the time that people can go to.
Yes.
It's crazy to me because I know storytelling has been around forever, but the popularity of it seems to be on the rise. Am I right?
Yeah, people are talking about storytelling.
Yeah, and doing classes.
Yeah.
So for a class, is there rules to storytelling? Or like what is, how would
no,
you...
No, the rules... just the rules of storytelling is you cannot read. You have to memorize. And the memorization is not line by line like theater people do. You read the story, and when you read the story, they will give you stories. And when you read the stories, then you make it your own. And it doesn't change the story, but it becomes yours.
Hmm. Okay. Yeah.
So somewhere, someplace in your life, there is an incident will have a relationship with that story. Otherwise, you won't pick it up. That's my belief, of course.
Yeah. That's neat. That's neat.
Yeah. So you, when you pick up a story, you know there is, and you like it, you know there is some kind of a relationship somewhere.
Yeah. Have you, do either of you have a favorite story, or do you guys remember the very first time you were told a story that, like, you've felt very attached to?
I can tell you, I'm old. My grandmother used to tell same story every night. And it was just before going to bed, and she will tell us the story, and then we have to go to bed. Yeah. That's it. So we knew that was end of everything. You have to be quiet and go to sleep. And that's to me was incredible thing, because I wasn't storyteller before. I had dance background, so I had a dance company and all those things. And all of a sudden, I realized Indian dance, classical dance, is all stories. They sing the story, but it's all stories. Uh-huh. And I've been telling stories with my body all my life, and then realizing when my body cannot work anymore as a dancer, then I started thinking, what am I missing? And then I found out that's the story.
Oh, wow. Okay. And Joanna, any early stories when you were checking out all those folktale books that stuck with you?
Well, there was no one particular story that stands out. I remember the first song I ever learned, and it's a story. I mean, every song is a story. But I do remember that my father, he's quite a storyteller. It's not his job, but he's just a storyteller. And he used to make up stories for me and my brothers and sisters, and we got to choose things that would be in the story.
Oh, wow. Oh, that's so fun.
It was really fun. And then at the end, it was always the same thing. We'd be, you know, like whichever characters, sometimes they had our names, would be stuck, and there was a witch or something. And then the good characters would say the magic words, which were something like "Lukita makita la chi chi chi," and then everything would be fine.
Oh, that's so fun! That's kind of like improv storytelling. Do you guys do that at your nights, where it's just like you get people to the audience to pick certain things you want to be part that they want
to
be part of?
I do it with kids. Yeah. I haven't done it on the Friday nights, but I do it with kids. Yeah, because they love it.
The kids are really they can do it. You know, they have no fear of anything, but with the adult, it's hard.
Do you find, speaking of audience members, are children a bit more receptive to storytelling than adults? Because I know adults can, especially in Toronto, can sometimes be a little cynical. Mm-hmm. What do you prefer for an audience?
The 1001 Night is all adult.
Yeah.
And they are just pin drop silence. You know, they are there to hear your story. Children are also can be very restless.
That's true.
But if you can get them with your story and just focus on them, they become quiet.
And, I mean, don't you find this too, Rubina? If a story is wonderful, then it wakes up a part of people that they forgot was there, you know?
Yeah.
And I know I went recently as an audience member. I went to the Moth recording that happened at Lure Doc's Hot Dog Cinema, and it was wonderful. That's a podcast show that does true life stories. They're always real life, and you know, that sort of thing's so popular right now. This American Life, all those sorts of things, and. Yeah, people came, and you know, it was a hot crowd, and people were hip, but the stories were moving, and you know, you end up in an audience, and a wonderful story gets told. You just feel things, and you know, you might have walked in cynical, you might have walked in thinking about, you know, this hat, that shirt, that lipstick, whatever you think about. But I mean, if a story's good, it just takes you somewhere.
Yeah,
stories has their own power. If you can tell them properly, it just takes you somewhere else.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting because I was thinking on my way here, my mother always told me bedtime stories, but they were my mother's Ethiopian, and she would tell me them in Amharic, which is the native language. And anytime she'd start the stories, I'm like, that's just Hansel and Gretel. That's just, and they were like the exact same stories that I'd hear here. So I feel like, I don't know how she would have gotten a hold of Hans Christian Andersen.
Yeah.
Because I don't think she did, but yeah. how stories just transcend different cultures. Did you find that, like, when you started learning about different stories?
Oh, my gosh. All of them, yeah. That they travel.
Yeah, they travel.
It's and, incredible. You know, you find yeah. a very, very old version of a very similar story
yes.
on opposite ends of the world.
Insane.
Cinderella made the rounds.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
Yeah, so there's Cinderella.
Well, everybody has Cinderella in their life, you know, the culture.
And what, there's Mossy Coat, that's one version
yes.
of Cinderella. Yeah. There's Ash Patel. Yeah. There's, you know, there's Cinderella actually is all over the world.
There's Ever After starring Drew Barrymore.
Yeah. And I think it's the Vietnamese version. She's got, like, these beautiful brocaded slippers.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. But that's so... That's awesome to me. That's crazy.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's travels. Stories travels. And there is somebody from one storyteller told that stories just floats and you can reach your hand and grab them and goes into your heart and you tell them and it becomes your story rather than... That story.
Yeah. Yeah, I believe that. Like, I was going to say, go ahead, Donny.
No.
I feel like I'm like, so many questions. But I know storytelling, we're saying it's popular. There's shows you can go to see. But do you find that people are hearing as many stories? Like, I felt like when I was younger, I was constantly bombarded with stories. Not bombarded, but I got to hear stories.
Everywhere.
Yeah, at school and on my, like, whatever show I was watching. Yeah.
Also,
yeah.
you would make up stories more when you're young.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. But do kids still do
You don't
that?
Know anyone who doesn't still make up stories all
yeah.
the time?
Yeah. Yeah. This guy's making up stories.
Yeah. Yeah. Especially boys.
Yeah. Yeah, but no, I know what you're saying. Like, whenever... I don't have neither me or Hannon have any children ourselves. When I'm around friends of mine with children, or it seems like a lot of the time they're on their tablets or you know, playing on the computer or on cell phones. Even I don't know. Is that sense of imagination, is that still thriving as much as it used to, or is it declining?
You just have to spend any time with kids to know that kids have imagination.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't internet that out of them.
That's true.
But whether you – I mean, imagination is one symptom of being able to play, you know? And I think whether a person can play or not is a choice at some point that they've made, you know? And I'm making this up as I say it, obviously, so
yeah, I like
might
it.
Go home and change my mind. But if a person has a playful spirit, they can engage with those things and tell stories and make up stories. And kids have very playful spirits. There are some children who maybe don't have playful spirits and they don't like the world of imagination as much. They want things to be concrete. They like math better, you know. But I think if you have a playful spirit, then the stories can be quite appealing, you know.
Yeah. So I'm just trying. I have a grandchild, 6 years old, and she wants me to not to tell her story. She wants me to hear her story.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And most of the time it doesn't make any sense. So what I started doing is I'll tell a story, short one, very, very short, 1 minute or two, and then I will say, draw. And we both will draw the story.
Oh, wow.
And then I will say, now what is this person is doing or this animal is doing? She will start telling all these, what he's doing and where he's going in the dark forest and all those things. And it becomes a long time. It becomes an hour and I get so tired. Say, okay, now stop. So those kind of things, don't you say that it will be good for them to learning process, you know, remembering and thinking and putting it all together as a language?
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure, yeah. Absolutely.
You know, those kind of things are so important for storytelling because before, you know, you read books to them and that's it. But now they're closing their eyes and they're listening to you. See, listening is very hard for a human being. Mm. They don't listen. Mm. But when you tell stories, everybody has to listen. Mm. So, and they learn that when they're little, they learn to listen. Mm. And that's such a good thing for them to listen instead of just saying all the time or playing with the thing. So I think it's storytelling has a lot of power on us.
Absolutely. Yeah. And speaking of listening, we're about halfway through the show. Joanna, do you think we could trouble you for a song here?
I'll do my best. So I write a number of songs based on folk tales. So I think I'll bring out one of those, and Ewan's going to join me on his narrative brassy instrument here. So this song is called Goose Girl, and it's based on a German Brothers Grimm tale with a princess. She has silver and gold hair. And it goes like this. Goose girl with the silver hair combs it all and keeps it fair. Where do all the pretty ones go? After the story's over. I started in the wrong key, Ewan. I'm so sorry. He looked like he was enjoying it. Wait, let me fix it. Goose boy wants it for his own, to cut it off and take it home. Where do all the pretty ones go? After the story's over. Well, Goose girl keeps the boy away by charming winds to lead her astray. Devil wants the pretty girl, he travels and he chases her all the whole world round. Where can all the good girls be found? Happy endings come and go. I'll read them to you so you'll know where they say the pretty ones go. After the story's over.
Ah, that was great. I think we're going to take a quick break here, and we'll be back with everyone in the studio talking more about storytelling.
Well, my daddy left home when I was 3, and he didn't leave much to Ma and me, just this old guitar and an empty bottle of booze. Now, I don't blame him because he run and hid, but the meanest thing that he ever did was before he left, he went and named me Sue. Well, I grew up quick and I grew up mean. My fists got hard, my wits got keen. Roamed from town to town to hide my shame. But I made me a vow to the moon and stars, I'd search the honky-tonks and bars and kill that man that gave me that awful name. Well, it was Gatlinburg in mid-July, and I'd just hit town, and my throat was dry. I thought I'd stop and have myself a brew. At an old saloon on a street of mud, there at a table, dealing stud, sat a dirty, mangy dog that named me Sue. Well, I knew that snake was my own sweet dad from a worn-out picture that my mother had had. And I knew that scar on his cheek and his evil eye. He was big and bent and gray and old, and I looked at him and my blood ran cold. And I said, my name is Sue. How do you do? Are you gonna die? Yeah, that's what I told him. Well, I hit him hard right between the eyes, and he went down, but to my surprise, come up with a knife and cut off a piece of my ear. But I busted a chair right across his teeth, and we crashed through the wall and into the street, kicking and a-gouging in the mud and the blood and the beer. I tell you, I fought tougher men, but I really can't remember when. He kicked like a mule and he bit like a crocodile. I heard him laugh and then I heard him cuss, and he went for his gun and I pulled mine first. He stood there looking at me and I saw him smile. He said, son, this world is rough, and if a man's gonna make it, he's gotta be tough. And I know I wouldn't be there to help you along. So I give you that name and I said goodbye. I knew you'd have to get tough or die. And it's that name that helped to make you strong. Yeah. Said, now you just fought one hell of a fight, and I know you hate me and you got the right to kill me now, and I wouldn't blame you if you do. But you ought to thank me before I die for the gravel in your gut.
Welcome back to Dum Dums. That was Johnny Cash, a boy named Sue, cut out before we got to the end of that story, but turns out kid ran into his dad at the end. Wasn't too happy about being named Sue.
Yeah. So. And before the break, we actually got to hear Joanna play.
Yeah, that was great. Do you have an album coming out?
Yes, I do. Thank you for asking. This summer, I'm recording an album. All the songs are based on folk tales, so it's a concept album. And Ken Whiteley is going to produce it. And I have an Indiegogo campaign going right now, so anyone who feels awesome can go to my website and check it out. It's joannacs.com. Yeah, I'm really excited.
Yeah.
We'll toss that up on our Twitter as well. If anyone sees it on at Dum Dums Radio, go over there and check it out. And could you give us some spoilers as to what folk tales to expect?
On the album, I did a whole right above them recently. So the song right before the break is based on a Brothers Grimm tale. I've got a couple songs based on New Zealand myths because that's where my dad's from. I've got one based on a story from Vietnam, one based on a Sudanese tale. So songs based on tales from around the world. Because as Sabina was saying, I can't actually tell all those stories, but I can write songs based on them, so it's nice.
Do you think as storytellers, you're kind of interpreters of these stories? You were mentioning before that there's all these common stories throughout languages and throughout history. Is it sort of the job of the storyteller to kind of be a conduit for those?
There are so many different ideas going on right now because my son just told me that the world is now all grown up and they're telling their own stories. So when somebody else doesn't belong there and make money out of the stories they tell, that's not fair. That's what he said to me. Right. So I said, I never thought of that. Mm-hmm. I thought everybody tells everybody's story. It becomes one world. That was in my head, especially in Canada. Mm-hmm. Because Canada, we are all come from everywhere. And we tell each other stories. It becomes such a beautiful world. I mean, peaceful world. But he said, no, everybody is growing up. So you don't tell everybody's story until you get a permission. But if you tell stories without just like volunteer storyteller or something like that, go ahead. Mm. But when you become a storyteller which is professional in that point, you have to get a permission. Just like any music get permission, right? If you want to take somebody else's music, you you write to them and they give you permission. Same thing. So it's becoming that kind of art form.
Yeah.
So it's like corporate. Neat. It's like it's pretty neat, you know, that way, because it used to be stories for grandma that tells stories and right. things like that.
Well, I think it's a great point that you're raising, because it's something I've been thinking about a lot and I've heard people talking about a lot, because there are stories that that I love. And, you know, when I was a beginner storyteller, I did. I told them in public. And then one by one, I was like, no, this is not working. This is not okay. It was awkward sometimes. But I think this is very recent. If you're getting paid for it, then you have a different kind of responsibility to the sources.
Yes, and of course.
I think the stories that I love, yeah, I can tell them to my niece, no problem, right? Yeah. Like, I can tell all those stories from wherever to my family and things like that. But
at home, everywhere.
Yeah, I mean, that's beautiful, I think. But, yeah, to go in front of a large group of people and on the one hand, take that place from someone else whose story it belongs to.
Yes.
And on the other hand, just sort of, there's something icky about it.
Yeah. Something not right.
I was under the impression that, like, a lot of the times these stories are so old. Like, it's almost a duty to pass down these stories to make sure that they still get heard.
And they do. Yeah. You know, right now, I just work with a group of people in Regent Park, in a community center.
Oh.
And they are they were all in their own language. They were telling us the story. Their own story. And sometime there will be Bangladeshi, you know, the other country from Africa. They were all sitting together. And one story somebody will say, and then everybody will say, oh, I have that story in different ways. But they all told their stories in their language, and they had interpreter who spoke in English.
Okay.
Interpret the whole story in English.
Oh, okay.
And that
idea.
Was so beautiful. I mean, when they tell you their story in their own language, it completely different, takes completely different power on story. But you know the story. So you can say it in English, but it doesn't have that rhythm, that, you know, that... I think mannerism and those
the
kind
cadence.
Of things. Yes, it's so different. So I enjoy listening to other language stories.
Yeah. Well, do you run into some of that when you mentioned you tell mostly stories about India and things? Do you kind of have to translate that not even just to English, but to sort of Canadian mindset, like?
Not lot of time, because stories are so similar into the life itself. You don't really have to give too much of the, but if you tell historical stories, then you do, you know. So it depends on what kind of stories you are telling. So then you give background where it's coming from and how it's. You know, when I tell my grandmother's story, I have to tell them when she was young. You know, that time was very different than right now if you go to India. So I have to tell them that that's why it's innocent and it's different. It's, you know, she talked to the crows, you know. Who will talk to the crows now? No, no kids will talk to the crows. They will play the, you know, their computer or something like that. So I give them that that background.
Right.
A little bit.
You change it a little bit to suit
so
their...
In every time you tell stories, you have to, at that moment, you decide you will or you won't.
Right.
And some story, even if you don't give them the background, it stands on their own.
Yeah.
It's powerful.
Hannon, I'm actually going to put you on the spot for a second.
Oh, no.
If you don't, it's all right, but do you happen to know any old stories from Ethiopia from your parents?
Yeah, well, the one my mom used to always tell me as a bedtime story is called Butu Bututu, and it was the Hansel and Gretel situation, except Butu Bututu was this crazy jungle lady that used to live in the forest, and the kids would always make fun of her, and... then the stepmother obviously sends the kids away because she doesn't want the kids around. And then Bututu steals them. And the only thing about it is that, like, the whole time as a kid growing up, I was like, I always felt bad for this character. And she doesn't win at the end. She ends up getting, like, killed. Spoiler alert. They ended up killing her at the end by putting a bunch of rocks in a pot and boiling them. It was supposed to be, like, the stew where they boiled the kids. This was, like, a nighttime story that my mom always told me. And she'd always, like, jokingly call me Bututu. But to this day, like, I sighed for Bututu because the kids were so mean to her. Uh-huh. And I don't know, it was a very similar story.
But she was a crazy jungle lady.
I know. She was like, she lived in the jungle and she never, and it's like, oh, okay. And it's like, oh, when's she gonna get the, because for stories I always want, like, you know, you always want the underdog to win. So do you guys find, like, how do you feel about, Alex actually added this question, ambiguous endings for stories?
I actually tell a lot of those tales myself because I read an old folk tale and I feel that way often. Like, one of the characters that originally you're just supposed to hate because once upon a time that was a useful thing. Just like, this person is just bad and they're ugly because they're all, you know, if they're bad, they're ugly. And if they're bad, they're also probably old, you know, like all those sorts of things. But we don't read it the same way these days. So it, often I'll tell a story and, you know, I have this cheeky, like, and the rest of them lived happily ever after, and the audience is like,
oh yeah.
But, you know, we have fun with it.
But stories, you know, the folk tale, you know, they come from different countries when you read them, and they come as they come. It's there. Yeah. And kids understand. I mean, they're not, we always say, oh, poor kids, we can't say that, he's dead. You know, but they understand.
My mom didn't care.
No, my grandmother didn't care.
My mom
told
was like,
us exactly the way. You know.
The other day, okay, so I went into one school and I was doing that song, There Was an Old Lady Who Swallowed a Fly. I don't know why she swallowed a fly. Perhaps she'll die. And we were having so much fun with the song. And then the next week I went into another school and I saw a different version of it that was put into a beautiful picture book for the kids. And, you know, we had so much fun the week before, like riot laughing and like, perhaps she'll die. It's just like so funny somehow. Yeah. And then I was in this new school and there was like this picture book and it's like, there was an old lady, she swallowed a fly. I don't know why she swallowed the fly. She won't say why. I was just like, that is a perfect example of something that, like, you're fixing that doesn't need fixing and it makes it so boring.
Yeah,
you know?
It does.
It just takes the heart and soul right out of it. And, you know, that's reading folk tales. That was part of what it fed for me that I was missing. It was like, I was reading things that were not the way they were supposed to be, you know?
Disney-fied.
They were Disney-fied. And it just made my spirit and soul happy to read about, you know, there was a character and her father, in a moment of stupidity, traded her by accident to the devil. He didn't realize she was behind the house at the time. He traded whatever was behind the house to the devil. And so he was like, ha-ha, I got your daughter. Anyway, so she's trying to avoid getting taken by the devil, and she's in this circle of salt, and she's praying because it was a pious tale, you know. All this. And so she's praying and praying and praying, and the devil's pissed off because she's praying, and she's in a circle of salt, so he can't touch her. What does he do? He gets the father to do all these things to her so that he can get at her so that her praying doesn't work.
At one point,
he gets the father to cut off her hands so that she can't pray and so that her hands will be dirty. Like, if your hands are dirty, then the devil can get you.
Yeah.
Back in that time, I don't know.
Anyway,
so
tears.
She's crying. Such pious tears and praying that it washes her stumps clean, and he still can't get her. So he gives up, and she goes like on this mad quest without hands. And, you know, she hasn't died from bleeding because it's a folktale. Nothing like that happens. She's just wandering. She has no hands anymore. She goes on this huge adventure, ends up marrying a king. And, you know, something like 14 years later, she's in this cabin in the woods with some angels, and she's still praying. And because she's nice and she's been pious the whole time, her hands grow back. Yeah. So no big deal.
Yes.
You know? And it all, you know, it's a very quick story. It all just rambles by, and, you know, she's good, so it all works out.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter that her hands got chopped off. They grew back.
No, because it's a story. But do you find that a lot? Because I do notice that with my niece and nephew, stories being changed slightly just to be a bit more I guess PC for children, but not even just like PC.
But they don't need it.
Yeah, and that's what I was thinking too.
They don't need it. It's the parents that are nervous.
Yeah.
It's the parents that are nervous.
It's, but the stories comes the way it's supposed to be.
Yeah.
The people who are writing the story, they have the vision of the story. So they're writing it. So if we keep changing it, it doesn't have the power of the same
power. Right. Right.
Yeah, and totally, and it does. Yeah.
I have a little story for you.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
So it's one time, it's a God story, so I don't know. Is that okay?
Oh, of course. Okay, this is Region Radio. Yeah, you do what you want.
If you could edit the God story, that would be really good.
I can't. This one I cannot. Yeah. So God is decided to hide from human being. God did not want to tell human being where he was. So somebody came and said, oh, go into the sky and hide there. I said, you don't know my children. Those human, they can find me. I said, then go into the ocean. It's so deep and way down. Nobody will find you. You don't know my children. They will go there and find me. I said, what are you going to do? And said, I don't know. So it went on. He sat on a meditation for a long time, and then God came out and said, oh, I know exactly right place to hide. What? Every human heart I'm going to hide so they cannot see me.
That's so nice. Wow. It's like such a surprise ending. I feel like I wasn't. Yeah. I wasn't. Thank you. Oh, that's so nice. I bet he would do that. So sneaky, that God.
Yeah. And we become a God.
Yeah. See, that's so great. And that's the thing, right? And some people would be like, well, you can't put God into the story, but it's just. Like, it's a story, and that's the way it was set up, and I think it's great to expose kids to all the different types of things.
Of course.
And as a kid, I wasn't thinking, like, oh, this lady's dead from a fly, or God is trying to hide from me.
When I was a kid, half of my, play was, making G.I. Joes, blow each other up. So, kids already... have a dark imagination.
Yeah.
And I think that's healthy.
And it's
I think that's reflected
darker
in these stories. And it's a kind of, I don't know. I think it's kind of parents kind of lying to themselves when they try to sugarcoat everything and clean everything up for kids, because kids are already mischievous by nature.
That's very true.
Now, on a bit of a different tone, I'm just wondering, what are some of the qualities that make a good storyteller? How do you be a good storyteller?
I've got two right away.
Okay, go ahead.
One is one of my biases, like musicality. And I've heard people that, I don't know if they'd ever played any music in their lives, but, they just, the pacing and all that sort of stuff. And then another thing is, I don't know how best to put this, but just like a very wise temperament, because you can tell a story and you can really communicate something. Or you can tell a story and you miss the whole point and nobody feels anything, It's like you can tell it's a good story, but it wasn't even really told, But sometimes someone just tells a story and you just feel something. And that's between the words, That's something of something bigger coming through.
Yeah.
Well, the voice is very important.
Yeah.
I can tell. Both of you ladies have there's a soft spoke, and it's not soft, it's not crazy, but there is a cadence to, I feel like, how you both are telling stories, even just conversing. It's it makes people captivated instantly.
That voice is very important. And another thing is, when you become a storyteller, you're memorizing, right? When you finish memorizing, it gets into your own body. The story gets into your own body. And when you tell the story, you're literally seeing it, what's happening. Mm-hmm. It's picture by picture by picture by picture. And when you're telling those, when you're seeing those picture, it comes with everything you have. And then people can move. They are seeing it with you. It's not like other art form, you know, on stage and you just sit there and watch and entertain you. Storytelling is a conversation. Although you are not speaking, but your eyes, your mind, I can tell you're listening to me or not. Mm. So it's those kind of things happening. So it's always warm places, you know, like not a huge place. Storytelling doesn't work on big, I think, but I was in one of these festival. Yeah. They put me on the Aga Khan Museum, on the auditorium. Auditorium. Yeah. Auditorium was huge. Yeah. When I went in there, I said, I can't tell story in here. Yeah. And they said, no, you'll be okay, you'll be okay. And then all of a sudden, the auditorium was packed. Mm. And when I started telling story, it didn't matter the big place because people were silent, listening. Mm. And just looking at their faces, because storyteller do not have to have all the lights on their faces. They can see you. So storyteller, I can see them. And I could see the kids are standing there like that. And I my heart was just going, okay, I'm in right place to take them somewhere. So it depends, you know, where you are and how you're expressing your story.
Well, have you ever had the sort of the opposite of that? Have you ever had a bad situation, something that didn't work for storytelling?
Lot. It's always that. Then you become better.
Okay.
Yeah, it's always. You go into some place and you don't know exactly where you're going, and you go in there, and then all of a sudden it happened to me. I'm from Winnipeg, right? So I went to Mennonite colony. They sent me, the Arts Council sent me Mennonite colony. And I went there and I dance with bare feet.
Yeah.
But I tell the stories, which is song. So before the song, I tell the story and then I use the song to move. And these Mennonite kids never seen anything like me before. You can imagine, I was sweating. And I was thinking, how am I going to get them in me? Yeah, I mean, it's impossible. And there was one boy, it was teenager. I think not really teenager, about 11, 12. You know, they're very hard to hold. Mm. So the one of the boy, he was laughing like this, you know, under the desk. I decided I'm going to get him.
Yeah.
I don't care who is there or not. So I just focused on him. You should have seen him. Poor guy.
Yeah.
Going like he couldn't move.
It's almost like dealing with a heckler. As a storyteller. Do you ever communicate directly to people in the audience when you're in the middle of stories, or do you just continue? Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't.
Yeah.
Whenever I do it, I go out of the story.
Oh, okay.
So I tried. It didn't work. A lot of people can. A lot of people can communicate with the audience and comes back to the story and back and forth. It's like playing tennis.
Mm-hmm.
I can't do it. I'm one thing I do.
Well, you just stare them down. You're just like, no way. I'm doctoring my set.
Yeah.
And for either of you, do you have any personal favorite storytellers?
Yes. I love listening to First Nations people. Their stories never ends and never begins. Mm. They move and move from one to another, another to another. And that's the storytelling, I feel like. That's a reality of the storyteller. Mm. You know, they know how to tell stories. So, yeah, that's my way of telling stories.
And Joanna, any favorites or?
Definitely not just one favorite, but I have a lot of favorites. The Toronto Storytelling Festival just passed. It happens every year, and who do they have this year that I love? I mean, Anna Kurtz is a favorite. I always say Kurtz. It's actually Kurtz.
Did you hear Ron Evans?
No. Yeah, Ron Evans is, I mean, one of both of our favorites, obviously. He's a Métis storyteller and oral historian, and just a stunning, stunning experience.
He stayed with me.
What? You have to stay with you? Amazing. That's so cool. Oh, my gosh. Storytelling rock star.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, the very first time I heard Ron Evans tell, I didn't really have any idea what I was about to experience. And he was at the end of a sort of evening of people telling I had told early on. And he gets up and he sits there and he's the headliner. He's got 45 minutes and he sort of sits there for a second and then says, well, and he explains to us that, you know, the way that you folks, like, you catalog your stories and then you can just pull them out, but we don't do it like that. You know, for us, stories are alive, and so I have to sort of hear what's happening and then a story will come.
Oh, wow.
And he was saying that the stories that were suggesting themselves, he knew that he couldn't tell them in under 2 hours because he's told them before and he can't tell them in less than 2 hours. So he was just waiting to see if a shorter one would come along. And he was like, just start saying things to me. And so people started saying this and that and the other thing. And finally he's like, aha, I got one. And then he spun 45 minutes straight, one of the most moving stories I've ever heard in my life. It was about two kids that escaped residential school. One actually made it.
Yes.
And just the journey that he went on and survived. And,
oh, wow.
And I've heard Ron Evans tell since. Some of them are myths, some of them are legends, some of them are true stories, and it's just stunning every time.
Ron Evans. Okay.
Yeah. Well, we're just about out of time here. Rabina, if anyone wants to find more information out about you, how would they go about doing that?
Oh, it's I'm writing on my son. ruby@devsinha.com. That's my email. And oh. I get it through email. I'm not very good at computer.
Just Google, people.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Rubina Sinha Google.
Yeah.
And Joanna, you talked about the Indiegogo campaign. Anything else you want to plug or should people check out, or just the website?
High Park is lovely this time of year.
Oh, absolutely. Oh, yeah. Gonna have the cherry blossom soon.
Yes. I'd like to plug the cherry blossom.
Yeah. Ewan, you've been quiet over there in the corner. Anything you want to plug before we head out today?
No, not particularly.
Ewan's good. So could we trouble you, Joanna, for one last song before we head out?
Sure. Yes. Yeah. I'll play this one because Ewan knows this one as well. And it's called... I won't tell you what it's called, but it's the first song off my most recent CD, and it's based on a true story of my own. I was on tour in Europe, and it was my first European tour, and I was so excited to be over there. I thought gravity wasn't going to work or something. I was just excited to be there, and I ended the tour in a very special place, and I wrote this. Sitting looking out the window of the 19th floor to the street below. Paris on the morning after. I try not to fall. I try not to fall. I'm falling for the romance, I'm falling for the stone, I'm falling for the man at home. I'm falling for the road, I'm falling for the road. So I cross over bridges to stare on and on. I'm searching for my song. I've been searching all along. Now I'm sitting looking out the window of another home. Every morning after the leaves, how they fall, I watch them as I fall.
Oh, beautiful.
Lovely.
Yeah, that was great.
That was so good.
Joanna, Rubina, thanks, Ewan, thanks so much for joining us. This has been Dum Dums Radio. We'll be here again next week and every Wednesday, 7 to 8. Thanks so much for listening.
Thank you, guys. So good.
Thanks for having
You're
us.
You're welcome.
Yes.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality. Open your eyes, look up to the skies and see. I'm just a poor boy, I need no sympathy. Because I'm easy come, easy go, little high. Killed a man, put a gun against his head, pulled my trigger, now he's dead. Mama, life had just begun, but now I've gone and thrown it all away. Mama, of a man.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango?
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
Galileo, Galileo. Magnifico!
I'm just a poor boy, nobody loves me.
He is just a poor boy from a poor family, sparing his life from this monstrosity.
Easy come, easy go, will you let me go?
Bismillah, no, we will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah, we will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah, we will not let you go.
Let me go!
We will not let you go.
Mamma mia, mamma mia,
mamma mia, let me go. Beelzebub has a devil put aside for me, for me.